Good morning. Thank you. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to come to talk to you, and also to Big Easy and the BNP Paribas Foundation, which are supporting my my trip here. It's not an audience I am used to. I am a scientist, but I welcome the opportunity to tell you it's part of our job as scientists to disseminate the findings and to educate the general public, the businesses, and also the policymakers. So I will tell you about climate-related impacts on the ocean and society, and also discussing the solutions. First of all, why do we need to care about the oceans? Well, simply, the oceans provide us with fantastic services. They moderate climate change. I will tell you about this in the next slide. They represent more than 90% of the habitable space on the planet. They provide more than 10% of the proteins eaten by humans. They host more than 25% of the high-level species on Earth. And finally, the ocean ecosystems such as mangroves, coral reefs, protect coastlines from the action of storms and cyclones. And if here, this is a business community, so I thought that if I put some dollars figures on the slide, it will be interesting to you. This slide shows the assets that the ocean represents, $24 trillion. It is a gigantic number. It is more than the combined sovereign funds of Abu Dhabi, Qatar, China. All of those combined are much less than the value of the ocean, $24 trillion. So that this is immense services. And when you look at the yearly gross marine product, of the ocean is $2.5 trillion. That's what you see here at the bottom. Every year, the ocean provides us with $2.5 trillion worth of services. The thing is that 70% of this value relies on healthy ecosystems. If we don't have a healthy ocean, the ocean will not provide us with those services any longer. So it's important to protect the oceans. And to put this into perspective, if the ocean was a country, it would be the seventh economy in the world, after US, China, Japan, Germany, France, and the UK, the seventh economy of the world. So it seems quite obvious that we need to care about the oceans. So what happens since the Industrial Revolution in the 18th century, we are releasing carbon into the atmosphere, CO2. We release about 10 petagrams, that is 10 billion tons of carbon every year, coming from the use of fossil fuels and also from deforestation here on the top. And fortunately, all the CO2 doesn't stay in the atmosphere. Some of it stays in the atmosphere, it's only 46%. Some of it is absorbed by terrestrial vegetation, that's a carbon sink, and also 28% are absorbed by the oceans. So if we didn't have an ocean, we would have more CO2 in the atmosphere and climate changes would be even more dramatic. But this is a large amount of CO2 that goes into the ocean. It's 26 million tons of CO2 every day go into the ocean. And this is making the ocean, as you will see, more acidic in the next slide. So the ocean is not only storing CO2, but it's also storing heat. The increased greenhouse effect increases the temperature of the atmosphere, but fortunately, the ocean is storing most of this heat. More than 90% of the heat generated by the extra CO2 goes into the ocean. What stays in the atmosphere is very little. This very small dot, that's the heat, that stays in the atmosphere and warms the climate. So we see the considerable role of the ocean storing that heat. The ocean, as I said earlier, absorbs CO2, which leads to acidification, that is, the acidity of the water is increasing. And finally, the ocean is storing most of the water that comes from the melting of ice caps and glaciers, which leads to sea level rise. As you know, the sea level is rising. It has risen by 20 centimeters since 1900, and it might rise up to at least 1 meter by 2100. So you see that the blue color is very obvious on this slide. It shows how the ocean is important for the Earth system. So what is ocean acidification? And don't worry, this is the only equation you will see in my slides. What happens is that when the CO2 goes into the water, when the carbon dioxide goes into the water, it combines with water to make an acid. This is an acid, it's called carbonic acid. So the acidity of the water is increasing as a result of this uptake of CO2. And each of us brings 4 kilograms of CO2 into water every day by our activities, by your transportation, heating, the industry. 4 kilograms go into the ocean. Of course, that's an average. Americans release, bring into the ocean maybe 20 kilograms, and African people, many of them will release much less. So that's a global average. And we do know that the ocean acidity has increased by 30% since 1800. And depending on the scenarios, the acidity will increase, maybe will triple by 2100. That's a major change to the ocean. So what we looked at in this study that we recently published, we looked at different scenarios. These are scenarios of CO2 release that were investigated by the IPCC, and we looked at 2 scenarios. So the first one is the business as usual scenario. We don't change anything. We continue to emit CO2 as we have done in the past, and this is increasing CO2 release into the atmosphere. And we looked at the second scenario, the high mitigation scenario. That is the scenario that will be discussed in Paris in December at COP21. This is the scenario that would enable to maintain the increase in temperature on Earth below 2 degrees. So that's the challenge of the climate conference in Paris, to make sure that we can fit to this scenario. You see, it's very ambitious because this scenario dictates negative emissions by the end of this century. Very, very ambitious. So those 2 scenarios have considerably different outcomes on the ocean. With the high emission scenario, 69% of the surface ocean will warm by more than 1.5 degrees and will increase their acidity by more than 50%, minus 0.2 units of pH. 69% of the ocean will be greatly affected. With the high mitigation scenario that I hope the climate conference will enable to achieve, only 1% of the surface ocean will be affected in a great way. So it really shows the outcome of this COP meeting. And this is one of the effects of warming and ocean acidification on coral reefs. You know, those systems which are in the tropics, which are beautiful, and which provide lots of income for those countries, for fishing, for tourism industry, and also for coastal protection. On the top here, we see a coral reef that is on the Great Barrier Reef that is very lively and intact. And that is the same reef, the same place, after a high temperature event. You see that the reef has bleached, and if the stress is too long, the reef will die. So that's an outcome of warming of the ocean. It's good for us that the ocean is storing heat, but it's not very good for marine organisms. And the at the bottom, we see the effect of ocean acidification. It's in Papua New Guinea. That's a coral reef at control pH, and this is a reef affected by natural CO2 sources. And you see that, in fact, there is only one coral species that remains here, as opposed to 50 coral species in this slide. It shows also the effect of ocean acidification. And in the future, we will have those two effects combined, warming and acidification, and we are very worried about the future of some systems. So here, this is the summary of this policy brief that I will discuss later. These are the two scenarios, the low CO2 emission scenario, the Copenhagen Accord that will be discussed in Paris, and this is the business as usual scenario. By the year 2100, with this high mitigation scenario, the ocean will warm by 1.2 degrees and plus 3.2 degrees with the high emission scenario. pH will change significantly more. Also, with the high emission scenario, and sea level will rise by almost a meter with the high emission scenario, and 0.6 meters with this one. So big differences. And then we looked at the risk of impacts on key marine organisms. Oh, sorry, hitting the wrong button. We looked at marine plants, mangroves, that's coastal forests, mostly in the tropics, tropical corals, theropods, which are organisms very important for the salmon industry, for example, in the North Pacific. Bivalves, this is oysters and mussels, krill, crustaceans that are eaten by whales, and fish. And then we looked at the risk of impact with the two scenarios using this color code: undetectable, moderate, high, and very high. I will not go into the details, but what you see is that with the low emission scenario, we are mostly in the white to yellow color, that is undetectable to moderate impacts, except for bivalves and warm water corals, which will be highly affected. With the business as usual scenario, the color is red to purple, that is high to very high impacts. So that will be a very dramatic effect on marine organisms. And we also looked at services provided by the ocean, carbon uptake, coastal protection, tourism in coral reefs, the fisheries and aquaculture of oysters and mussels, and fisheries in low latitude and fisheries at medium and high latitude. And again, without getting into the details, with the low emission scenario, yellow to white, it's not too bad. With the high emission scenario, purple, red to purple, that is high to very high risks of impacts. So what can we do? And I like this graphic put together by a colleague of mine from Stanford University, Ken Caldera. Everything starts with this desire that we have to have a better life. We want to have a better life than our parents, and we would like to have our children having a better life than ourselves. So to improve our well-being, we need to consume goods and services. What we can do is to conserve those goods and try to recycle and use less of goods and less services. That's a way we can improve our carbon footprint. Of course, consuming goods and services requires energy. At the moment, most of the energy is from fossil fuel. What we can do to bring those goods and services is to improve the efficiency of the industry, of the transportation sector, etc. So increasing efficiency is a good way to reduce the consumption of energy. And then we have, once the CO2 is emitted, and to avoid releasing too much CO2, low emission energy technologies such as renewables are of course a good way to limit CO2 emissions. And this is a nice way to limit the impacts on the ocean. Here you see, for example, ocean pH, the ocean acidity. With the low emission scenario can be stabilized, we can moderate and in fact completely stop the decrease that will occur with the high emission scenario. So there is a way to stabilize the planet by reducing those CO2 emissions. Once the CO2 is in the atmosphere, what do we do? There are ways to remove or to avoid having CO2 in the atmosphere in the first place, and that is what is called carbon dioxide removal on this part of the slide. We can capture CO2 at the site of production and store it in reservoirs, underground reservoirs that were empty gas reservoir, for example, the oil reservoirs, and store the CO2 there, hoping that it won't come back. So that is storing CO2 and make sure that it doesn't go into the atmosphere. What can be done also is to increase forestation, because plants also absorb CO2. That's a good way to avoid having too much in the atmosphere. But this is very difficult to do, I mean, the carbon dioxide removal. It works at a small scale, but it doesn't work at a large scale. And to avoid having the change in climate and to avoid ocean acidification, some people are thinking about geoengineering in another way. That's on the top of this slide. But this is called solar radiation management. The goal of those geoengineering techniques will be to continue to emit CO2, but without warming the atmosphere. And the way to do that is to decrease the amount of sunlight that goes to the Earth's surface by having like big giant umbrellas in the atmosphere and reflecting to space some of the solar radiations, or by adding clouds, pumping water vapor into the atmosphere, or adding sulfur, which provides more clouds, and to have reflective aerosols. So those techniques are, of course, many of us are against the use of those techniques because we don't know whether we'll be able to control them. And on top of that, ocean acidification is not solved with this technique, because the goal is to continue to release CO2. And mechanically, as we release CO2, 30% will go into the ocean. So that's not a nice way to solve the problem. In fact, it doesn't solve the problem. So what we can do also to avoid impacts on ecosystems and humans is to adapt and also to increase resilience of marine systems by, for example, increasing marine protected areas, marine parks, reducing overfishing. And in the end, adaptation could also be to adapt the industry. For example, the oyster industry in the US has adapted, but in a very weird way. What happens is that on the northwest coast of the US, along the coast of Oregon and Washington State, there are many problems with acidification because the oysters are not reproducing anymore. So the industry has dipped for 5 years. There are no reproduction of oysters. So one company, relocalized its production of young oysters to Hawaii, because there is not such big deal with ocean acidification. But what is really stupid is that once the young oysters are produced, they are flown back to the US for growing. So in fact, when you leave adaptation to companies, sometimes it can be completely stupid, because to avoid the result of CO2 emissions, what the company is doing is releasing even more CO2 by using airplanes to fly the young oysters back to the US. So in the end of this circle, the objectives we had in the first place to improve well-being is not reached. In fact, we are damaging the planet. We are also having issues with the services that those ecosystems provide to us, and perhaps, in fact, our children will not have a better life than we had, and which was not the goal of this whole process. So anyway, we have four key messages to everyone, to the general public, but also to policymakers, and these messages are explained in a policy brief that will be on the table outside this room. You're welcome to take a copy of this policy brief that we also distribute to the COP21 negotiators. And several of us will be at COP21 explaining the outcome and making sure that the ocean is taken into consideration. So the key messages are that the ocean strongly influences the climate system and is an important provider of key services, very valuable services. We have already seen impacts on the oceans, and there is a high risk of impact even with the low emission CO2 scenario. And therefore, there is an immediate and need to reduce emissions to prevent those massive and mostly irreversible impacts on the ocean. And finally, I didn't have the time to discuss this, but as CO2 increases, the options to adapt and to repair the ocean become fewer and less efficient. So now I will summarize this into a simple 3-minute movie that was prepared by us to educate the public and also the policymakers. We will show this movie in Paris in December on several occasions. This movie, we will see it in English, but it is also available in Chinese, Spanish, and French. And the goal is really to paint a hopeful picture of the situation and show the public and policymakers that, and also the businesses, that it is time to make change, and it's not too late to stabilize the situation and try to minimize the impact. So.
Did you know that each day more than 1/4 of the carbon dioxide emitted by human activity is absorbed by the oceans? Without them, the effects of climate change would be far greater. But the oceans have just about had enough, so to speak. The amount they have absorbed is now causing a drop in the water's pH. If you remember what you learned in science, then you will know that this means that the acidity is increasing. By the year 2100, scientists predict that the pH will have fallen by 0.4 units compared with its mid-19th century level. That corresponds to a threefold increase in the water's acidity. The risk, then, is that it will be more difficult for marine plants and animals to produce their skeletons and shells. Can you imagine what a mussel without its shell would look like? Added to that, the water in the oceans is getting warmer, and not just at the surface, but deep down as well. This could cause certain species to migrate, reduce the quantity of oxygen in the water, and seriously damage the health of coral reefs. This would endanger the habitat of thousands of fish species. Moreover, you know that with climate change, the polar ice and glaciers are melting, which means global sea level is rising. There is a risk of causing dangerous changes to our coastal landscapes, especially in low-lying areas. If we combine acidification with warmer oceans and sea level rise, then the whole marine ecosystem is under threat. Imagine what would happen if plankton and calcareous organisms were to disappear. Their predators might migrate, change prey, massively destroy other species, or even disappear. And as you know, we humans are at the end of the chain. All these changes risk having a serious impact on our economies, our food, and our health. We are therefore all concerned. Our future and that of our oceans are intimately linked. That is what is at stake in the major climate conferences. All efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions are crucial. All of them, whatever they are.
Okay, I think it was it switched off. So anyway, if I can get the slides back, I would like just to conclude that things are look promising for COP21. There are 150 countries have provided their contributions to reducing CO2 emissions. It's not ambitious enough, but we are on the right track, and that hopefully a mechanism that will be successful will start in
Paris. We all hope that will be a successful conference, that a treaty will be signed. And so you see today, as I speak, 154 countries have provided their emissions. There are very few that remain to be given. So the process is started. And I would like to finish by thanking the BNP Paribas Foundation and other sponsors of this Ocean 2015 initiative, which has the objective to bring the oceans on the table of negotiations at COP21. Thank you very much.
Dziękuję. Przypomnę raz jeszcze, jeżeli mam...